Hello, and happy Sunday, data science streamers. If any of you are out there, welcome to the stream, Sunday Data at a new time. We're going to do some data science with Python and SQL today. We're going to talk about something called customer churn, and we're going to listen to some good electronic music, copyright free, courtesy of Spotify, copyright free streaming music channel. My name is Carl, and I'm a data scientist in Silicon Valley, California. Hey, Michaela ZTK. Welcome back. Nice to have you with me again. And I guess this is a relatively friendly time for Europe. That's my intention. I tried doing a really European friendly time last year in 2020, and I was like up at 9 a.m. on Saturday, and it was friendly for Europe, but it wasn't so friendly for me. So this is the new European friendly. I hope we can make it work. If you haven't been on my streams before, you'll know I spend a while talking at the beginning. You won't see any Python and SQL for a few minutes, but that's just to level set everyone, give everyone the background so everyone knows what I'm talking about. They say a big part of data science is what they call domain knowledge, which basically just means knowing what you're talking about in the real world, not just from looking at the data. So without further ado, I'll try to get through my usual opening bit, and then we'll get to some new data science and SQL and stuff today. All right, so what is churn? If you haven't heard, churn is when subscribers, customers, or users quit. They quit your product or service. Why? I don't know, because they've got other choices. We all have so many choices nowadays. I think that's why there's such a churn problem. It's a problem of too much choice. So this is a problem for any product with recurring revenue, which means repeat purchases. It could be a paid subscription, like subscribing to a Twitch channel or to a product like Microsoft Word. It could be a free subscription supported by ads like YouTube, for example, or I guess just using something like Twitch in general, or in-app purchases. Anyway, all the same, churn affects them all. You want your customers to keep coming back. So churn comes from the churn rate, which is the percent of customers that drop out in a given period of time, like a month or a year typically. And I did an entire stream, actually I did three entire streams on calculating churn rates recently. So we won't go into too much details on that today, but there's plenty of information out there. Churn is not just a rate, it's also a verb nowadays. You can say the customer churned, or even you can say I'm churning from Netflix because I made a resolution to read more books this year. Actually, I'm keeping the Netflix subscription and I'm going to read more books this year. But anyway, churn is also a noun. You can say make a churn report for last quarter, or you can even refer to a customer as a churn. You can say like, oh, the customer canceled last week, they're a churn, so don't help them out anymore. So that's the uses of the word churn. And why learn about churn? Well, it's the most common data science problem in the world, I say. No one's challenged me on that, so if there's a more common data science problem than churn, let me know. But churn is so common because every product or service has a churn problem. Every product or service. But there's special things about churn which are different from most other data science problems, and we're going to go through some of those on the stream. Also, this is a great way to learn data science foundations, because in these streams, I go from raw data to the end result, which is taking action. A lot of data science education, they kind of drop a data set in your lap, and then they teach you an algorithm, and then you helicopter to another scenario without really finishing it. So this is a cool way to learn data science, going from all the way, they say soup to nuts is like an English expression, which means everything from beginning to end. And what is Fighting Churn with Data? That's a book that I wrote. It's based on my experience as chief data scientist at a company called Zora. I'll tell you about that in just a sec. And the book is out now. You can get it at my publisher's website, shown here. with a discount code, 40% off. And you can also get it on Amazon now. But you don't need to buy the book. If you watch these streams and download the open source code, you really don't need to buy the book. So it's up to you. If you want it for extra reference, have at it. So what was Zora? I mentioned I worked at a company called Zora. It's a platform for subscription products and services that many companies use, but you have probably never heard of Zora. You probably don't know how to pronounce it either. No one knows how to pronounce it. How many times have I spelled Zora for people on the phone when I tell them where I work? Z-U-O-R-A. It's one of those cool names that comes from it's the founders of the company. There were like three founders and they mashed up their names together and that's how they came up with Zora. But it's kind of an iconic word now, Xerox or Zoom. Zoom is a Zora customer. You can see right here next to me on that slide. So what does Zora actually do for a company like Zoom? It's where Zoom manages their subscriptions and their customers. So if you sign up for a Zoom subscription, your subscription information is actually entered in Zora's secure data center. So Zora sits on the back end managing the data for all these companies. And that's how I came to work on churn data for so many different companies. You know, most data scientists just work on churn for a single company, the one they work at. But at Zora, I worked on churn for many, many companies. I said I did churn analysis for other companies. How much time does churn analysis take? Well, it depends. In the early days of me doing it, I was still developing my method. And now I have a very refined method for doing a churn analysis, which is what the book is about. At this point, if I have the data loaded into a database, I can do a churn analysis, you know, the complete one in, you know, like under a day, just like a couple of hours. Because what I've worked out over all of these experiences is like a, what's the right word? It's a process, like a factory process to analyze churn. And that's what I teach in this book. It's a series of steps where if you take all these steps, then you're gonna do a pretty good job of the analysis. Now I say you can do it in a couple of hours. That's for initial results. There's always a lot of iteration and improvement. And it's really never done for a real live company because as soon as you finish your churn analysis, they'll come out with new product features, or you'll have a new competitor in the market, or the market conditions might change. So for a real company, churn analysis is an ongoing concern. But once you're set up, each iteration to improve the analysis will only take a couple of hours. Let's go into the details of that process. What's next in my presentation here? Oh, the next part is, what does fighting churn with data really mean? It actually means to use your data to reduce churn. That's the only point. You want to have less churn. So you improve your product. Always the best way to have low churn is to have a great product. And you can use your data to figure out what customers love and what they hate without surveys, because surveys are biased and they're a pain in the ass to administer. But you've got all this data lying around, so just use it. Next, you're going to do some marketing to your customers. You want to give them targeted messages about the features they really would love but aren't using, so you're not spamming them. There's also customer success and support. You can use your data to figure out, you know, if customers are having a hard time, and then maybe offer them an onboarding or training, like one-on-one. And lastly, your sales and pricing. You can right-size your plan by using like a basic standard premier plans. They call that a good, better, best plan in the pricing lingo. And then you're going to get customers value at all different levels of use, but without giving out discounts. A lot of people think fighting churn is about giving out discounts, but it's actually a really bad way to fight churn because in the long run, it undermines your pricing. People realize that you're giving out discounts when someone says they churn, and then they just call up and say they're gonna churn to get the discount. So who's done that? Anyone who's old enough did that with the cable and satellite companies, you know, because they always fell for that one. Anyway, all right, where's the data? There's a social network simulation. Let's see. This is how you actually get this data. There's code on GitHub in open source repo, and to follow along with everything I'm gonna do in the stream today, you have to do some setup, which, well, of course you have to clone the repo. We use PostgreSQL and Python in the code examples, and then there's a simulation where we create the data. So let's look at the data so I can level set for everyone about what kind of data we're gonna have in the stream. Let's see, this is gonna be my last SQL from last stream. Maybe I can just rewind a bit. Yeah, I'll just rewind my old queries. That's using my head. So there's subscriptions in this simulated data. We'll look a little bit at them. Okay, there's 54,000 subscriptions. And let's look at them. Let's see more. All right, here's the subscriptions for one account, account ID 3. So we've got account IDs. That's one part of this data. And every subscription is for a range of dates and has a price. We don't really use the price in this analysis. This is not a perfect simulation, but leave that aside. The important fact is you have these subscriptions where the end date of one lines up with the start date of another. And that's called co-term or co-terminal subscriptions, where the term of this subscription lines up with the term of the next subscription. And so you have multiple subscriptions per account spanning the length of time that the customer was a customer until they churn. Let's find some customers who churn. I'll just put a little limit in here. Let's see, because we don't want to look at everything. Order by account ID and start date. So when a customer churns, there's actually not a field or flag in the data that tells you that. Their subscriptions just run out. Like here, this account, I'm trying to find someone who actually churns before the simulation ends, because the simulation ends in June. Most of these people seem to be keeping their subscriptions the full length until the end. But I know there's some people in here who churn. I mean, I wrote the dang simulation. All right, here's someone who churned in May. So this account number 12 started on June 6th. They had 4 subscriptions and ended May 6th. And then they became a churn because they have no more subscriptions. So the subscription is just one part of the data that we use for fighting churn. In fact, it's only the real basics about who signed up and when. What's actually kind of more interesting is the part about what the people did. So that's in the event data. I'm looking for my old query here. Here we go. This is some of the event data. Doesn't look so exciting like this, but this shows that every event has an account ID and a time, and there's also a type code. And if I go back to my old query, let's see, maybe I should just update this query. So the events are in a table, and there's another type table, and I'll join on that type table to show you what the events really consist of. Here's event type T on, we have to join them on the event type code. Isn't there an ID for this or something? Yeah, event type ID. Let's see. All right, now this will give us a better look at the events, because you'll see now that these events actually correspond to typical actions that people take on a social network, because the simulated data is a social network. So you've got events like liking, viewing ads, so there are supposedly ads in this simulated social network, liking, there's also messaging and replying, posting. So those are all the events, and that's really all the data produced by the simulation, is a sequence of subscriptions for each account and the actions they take, and then eventually they churn. So it's not real, but it's a very realistic simulation in that it reproduces behavior that looks like a real product or service. And let's look at some examples of that. Going back to the slide deck here, let's see. All right, the events are just the start, And if you saw the previous streams, the next thing that we do is calculate metrics. And so customer metrics are like a simulation, a summary, I should say, not a simulation. Metrics are a summary of the events for each account at a given point in time. And they're literally aggregations over customers and time reinserted into the database into a new table called the metric table. Hey, let's look at the metric table. I don't think I've done that in a while. So if I just go here and select star from socialnet2.metric, limit 100 because we don't want too much data. So here's a sequence of metrics for account one at a range of dates, and these are all the same metric ID. There's another type table here, so let's inner join on that one so we can see what the metrics really look like. So there's a metric name table. N dot metric name ID. And this should be a little bit more interesting. So now you can see the events are, the metrics rather, are related to the events. So we've got like per month as one metric. Eventually we might see, no, that's the only one. Let's do this differently. We'll order by, whoops. Order by, let's see, account ID and metric time? I don't know, I'm trying to think of how we can see some more. Okay, here we go. So you can see this account has a like per month metric, add new per month, message per month, and these are all the aggregated sum of the events for that account at that point in time. So let's go to the code and look at that. This is my little slide that reminds me to go to the code and reminds you where the code is. So this is listing 3.1, which means it's chapter 3, listing 1 from Fighting Churn with Data. And this will be the demonstration of calculating a metric. And sorry for everyone who's seen this before, but I like each one of these streams to be kind of, you know, independent. You can just kind of like tune in and watch this and you'll get all the background you need to follow the advanced stuff that comes later in the stream. So here we're going to run a metric using the framework that comes with the book. So here I have a wrapper program that runs it. So I'm just going to tell it to run chapter 3, listing 1. Whoops. All right, so that is running it. You can see it prints out the SQL it's running right here. We can look at this SQL a little bit more closely. You can see it really is just a simple aggregation. This one is on account ID because we're calculating for one specific date. In this case, here's the result. So it does a group by account ID, counts the number of events, and we've limited the events to one particular name. In this case, it was the like events. So you can see here the bind variable. And it's within the past 28 days. So this is how we get all these metrics. But at this point in the analysis, I've already calculated all the metrics. So that was an earlier phase of the analysis when I calculated a bunch of metrics. And we can see a summary of those metrics here. Well, no, we'll see a summary of those metrics later, soon. First, I'm going to tell you what we're going to do in the stream. Today, we're going to talk about understanding churn and behavior, which means now that we've measured customer behaviors with metrics, we want to know how these behaviors actually relate to the customers churning or renewing their subscription. And you may think that when we're going to do this, we're going to use machine learning or regression because we're talking about understanding the outcome of churn using the data. And the way most people do that is with machine learning or regression. But actually, we're not going to use regression or machine learning yet, although it comes later. First, I advise people to do some good visualization and analytics because you can really understand the most important things about churn just from doing that. And I've got this quote here that says, if you need to use statistics to understand your experiment, you ought to have done a better experiment. And that comes from Ernest Rutherford, who got a Nobel Prize in chemistry in 1908. And you might wonder why he would say a thing like that. And I think there's a few reasons. One is that Rutherford worked in the early 20th century when experimenters in physics, he was a physicist studying radioactive decay, they wired up their own equipment. And if they messed it up, they would have noise in their measurements. And then they'd have to use statistics to average out the noise. And I think he was kind of disparaging people who do a sloppy job on their rig, which is what you call an experimental apparatus, for those of you who have never been in science. But I think there's a deeper level to this, which is also that when you do an experiment, you should be able to read the result to a first-order understanding just from a visualization. And if your visualization doesn't show clearly the effect that you're looking for, you should try a different experiment. Don't fiddle around with the statistics and see if you can make the result look better. It doesn't look that significant, but it passed a 95% confidence test. It's usually better just to find a new hypothesis to test, because in this type of work, churn and retention, the most important conclusions that you're going to make don't require statistics. So let's get into it and actually look at the type of analytics that I'm talking about. Well, one type of analytics is to do an overview of your data set. And this is an overview of the data set that we created earlier. It shows you all the metrics in the data set. Here on the left, we've got that like per month metric. And here, just reading it off, you can see 99% of accounts have a non-zero value for like per month. The mean is 95, but there's a lot of extreme outliers. It goes up to 6,700. As a result of that, the metric is very highly skewed, with a skew of 10.8. That's very skewed. And that can be a problem, and we're going to deal with that today, actually. Now, some of the other metrics we've calculated are new friend per month, post per month, ad view per month. So every one of these metrics, I mean, every event in our social network gets a metric. There's also a metric, account tenure, which is the simple age of the customer. And let's see, this overview of the data set was created with a code listing 5.2, which I went over in actually just the last stream, but maybe we could go take a quick look at it. It's actually a pretty simple SQL. Actually, no, this is not done with a SQL. What am I talking about? It's a simple, let's definitely look at it then, because this is actually done with pandas. And let's look at it. Let's see. So I'm going to go to chapter 5, listing 2, to look at the data set stats, to summarize the data set. I've already got a breakpoint set in it, so let's just go right into it. I do have to make sure I'm on the right configuration. Oh no, here we go, 5.2, I already have it set. Let's just debug this. All right, finally doing some live code. So now we're going to look at very quickly how to make a data set summary the way I like to do it, because I do a little bit of extra stuff on top of the Python standard. So first I'm just loading my data set right here. I check that the path to the data set is a path, and then I use pandas read CSV. So now I've loaded my data set into this variable, which I call churn data. And we can look at it quickly, so I can show you all. Wow, that was a total crash. Sorry about that. I don't know what the hell is wrong with my system sometimes. I can't figure out what causes it to crash when I'm streaming. I used to blame it on Microsoft Excel, but I don't think it was Microsoft Excel this time. Let's see, where were we? We were talking about how to do a data set overview like this one. And I was stepping through some Python code. Let's see if we can get the Python back open. Whoops. So this is not the listing we were looking at. We were trying to debug listing 3.5.2, actually, if I recall correctly. we were talking about how I get statistics for one of these data sets. And this is what we were doing when I crashed. Maybe I need that pie chart update. Hey, 2001 Q fills. Thanks for following. Apologize for the, can you say Porco Dio? I don't know. What does it mean? Does it mean, damn it, my stream crashed? I'll say that. But anyway, welcome 2001 Q fills. I'm gonna attempt to debug this again. Oh, it's like, hello in Italy? Cool. I don't actually know any Italian, but that's good to know. So I was trying to debug this. I'm gonna live dangerously and try to debug the same code again, because this doesn't usually crash like that. This is where I load the data set, and I crashed looking at the data set. I'm afraid to do it again, but I just have to know if this is what causes a crash. I wasn't really patient here. Maybe I should have been more patient after I pressed this evaluate button. Because the cool thing in PyCharm is that you can just look at your data frames like this. And usually it does not crash your computer. Okay, see, it worked this time. Urban Dictionary first. Before saying that, like hello in Italy. Is that a not always a nice way to say hello? I'll have to look it up. But thanks for the advice, Nicole, and welcome back to the stream. Thanks for sticking with me after I completely crashed. Anyway, this is what a data set looks like once you've loaded into Python. We have the account ID and the date of the observation are formed into the index. Whether it's a churn or not is in the second column, and the rest of these columns are all the metrics. So it's one observation of each account per row, one metric per column. So to make this dataset summary, there's a few steps to take. The first is to churn the churn variable into a float so that we can take statistics on it. Most of the statistics I take are with the pandas describe function, which is a great way to get a description of your data. If you will do another look at it here, this is what you get from the summary function, viewing it as a data frame. So we get the count, the mean, standard deviation, min, max, and the quartiles, all from calling pandas describe. Now I take a few additional statistics in my summaries, which is why I have my own wrapper function to do this. I take the skew, which tells you if there are extreme outliers above the mean, and also the first and 99th percentile. And lastly, the percentage of accounts that have a non-zero value for the metric, which is done with this, summing the metrics as bool and dividing it by the number of rows. And then I just save it. So that is how I take my own summaries. With listing 5.2 in the book, and it just is like the pandas describe, but has a few extra fields which I think are really useful for customer data sets. Now, this is actually one of the main techniques we're going to talk about today, which is calculating metric cohorts, which is a way of seeing how churn and behavior relate to each other. And this is data from a real company data set here. I'm going to talk you through it, and then we're going to look through some more plots. Metric cohorts means dividing the customers into groups based on the value of the metric, so that the customers with the lowest value of the metric are all in the bottom cohort, like a decile, the first decile. The next group will be customers with a little bit higher metrics, and then you go on up until the top cohort is those with the highest. So this is for Clipfolio, which is a company which makes BI dashboards for analytics and businesses. And the lowest cohort here has about zero dashboard edits per month. These are like the edits on Clipfolio. And the top cohort has more than 150 edits per month on average. And the vertical axis is showing you the churn rate in each cohort. But without showing you the numbers, because this is some real company data, I'm not allowed to share the churn rate with you. They let me share this kind of qualitative data with you, but I'm not actually allowed to tell you their churn rate. But on the y-axis, the bottom of the graph is zero churn. So what you can see here is those customers who have basically zero edits have something like, I don't know, 8 or 10 times the churn of those customers who are doing 150 edits a month. And just a few edits a month corresponds to a big drop in the churn rate. And this is very typical for all products and service. When you look at the rate at which people do the most important behaviors on the product, you see a very strong relationship to churn. So just before I crashed, I was talking about hypothesis testing without using statistics. So here we're testing the hypothesis, do customers who edit their dashboards churn less than customers who don't edit their dashboards? And here's the answer. Yes, you do not need statistics to know that doing a lot of dashboard edits is good. Here's a question from Mikola ZTK. What tools, languages do you use besides SQL, Pandas, and Matplotlib? Well, that's most of them. There's just one more very important one there, and that's R. Because I'm a very bilingual data scientist. I like R and I like Python. I like them for slightly different things. I like R for cleaning data and munging data and doing any kind of rough and ready analytics. And I like Python for code that's gonna run in production for me. So anyway, I say don't forget the R, because anyway, it works for me. Let's look at some more metric cohorts though, because I've got a lot of them. This one is for a company called Broadly, which is a service which helps businesses manage their online reviews. And again, you can see this is like the reviews per month, the reviews updated per month. And you can see very clearly, here's the hypothesis. Do review updates lead to lower churn for customers of Broadly? And the answer is yes, and I don't need statistics. Look, those customers that have like zero review updates have about double the churn rate of those customers that have 4 or more review updates per month. So here's hypothesis testing without statistics. You can read the result from this plot without really doing any stats to worry about if this is significant, because especially for charts like this, I've seen so many of them. You know what the meaning of this is. Here's a third company, Versature. They're a telco, so it's a business phone service, and the metric is the number of the call time per month. So now we're testing the hypothesis, does having a lot of calls lead to someone not churning from Versature? And the answer is yes. Zero calls has about 4 times the churn rate of everyone who has more than 2,500 minutes per month. So, I like to say the metric cohorts, they all look the same when your data is good. And every product or service should have some metric cohorts that look basically like this, or something's wrong. Something could be wrong with your data, or something could be wrong with your product or service, but these are very standard results. So let's look at how to get these results. This is listing 5.1, and we'll do one run through, and then we'll look through the result, and then we'll get to some new stuff. New meaning it wasn't in the last stream. So let's see, back to looking at a listing 5.1. This is how we make the cohorts. And I've already got a breakpoint here. So I just need to, let's see, which one is this? I'm gonna duplicate this. And I'm just gonna say this is a configuration. These are the run configurations to run the wrapper program. I call it a wrapper program because it wraps all the code listings. So when you want to run a code from the book, you just specify the chapter and the listing as arguments to this script, run churn listing. And we'll be debugging this program in no time at all. So here we are doing the metric cohort. As usual, first thing, open the data set. That's what crashed me earlier today, so I'm not gonna open the data set right now. Let's just like leave well enough alone with that data set. Now here is where we actually do the grouping into the cohorts. This very important function, qcut. Let's see, does this show us more? Nah. Sometimes it gives me like the documentation for the function in the pop-up. I'm not sure how to make that happen. But Qcut is quantized discretization. And it, what that means is it groups the data according to quantiles, which means like the deciles. So the number of cohorts is defaulted to 10 here. So this is going to try to form the 10 deciles of customers. That means like the bottom 10%, the next 10%, etc. And that's going to be stored in a series variable called the groups. Now we're not done with the result yet because we have to calculate the mean value in each cohort and the churn rate in each cohort, which is done using pandas group by function on the groups and then calculating the mean. So these two steps is actually what really gives us the result for the cohort analysis, which is the mean value in each cohort and the churn rate in each cohort. And then I put them all into a data frame. And at this point, you can actually just look in this data frame and see the result for this cohort analysis. And the rest of this is actually just plotting it. And so I'll just like let it run out now. And we'll look at the result from this cohort analysis saved in my folder here. Let's see, actually we can look at all the cohort analyses that we ran in the last stream. I'll open these all up. So most of these were run in the last stream. I just reran one of them a moment ago. Let's start with the ones that look nicer. So here's the cohort for reply per month, which is one of the messaging features of the social network, the simulated social network. And you can see that very standard shape for a cohort, a behavioral cohort. Those who have pretty much zero on the metric are churning at the highest rate, in this case around 7%. And those with the most highest values on the metric, the cohort that averages around 60, churns at much lower rate. And now here I'm actually showing you the churn rate on the y-axis because this is simulated data. You're allowed to see the churn rate from the simulation. And of course, if this was really your own product or service, you would be able to see the churn rate. So I only don't show the churn rate on my confidential case studies that I'm sharing with you and in the book. So that's really all over the book. All right, so more cohorts. Here's the cohort for post per month. Looks very similar, but this is actually even more significant because the bottom cohort here has like 9% churn and the top cohort is below 2%. So you can see it actually makes a bigger difference. Well, it's close. Anyway, here's another one, new friend per month. Yeah, this one is really strong. More than 10% churn for those who have very few new friends per month, but then below 2%. So they don't all look this good. Here's one that looks a little bit messier. This is for dislikes per month. And you can still see that more dislikes per month leads to lower churn. Now you might be thinking, isn't that weird that more dislikes per month leads to lower churn? Well, this is a case of, you have to question the correlation and causation. So dislikes per month probably don't cause lower churn. What causes lower churn is people who use the service a lot. So probably disliking a lot is correlated with things that really cause lower churn. And we're going to look at techniques to understand that in a future stream, but not quite today. Let's see, this one is unfriends per month. There's another one. It seems a little bit weird that more unfriends per month is causing lower churn. Ad views per month. And lastly, account tenure. You can do cohorts in account tenure. And for the simulation, you get this result that churn peaks around 60 days and then decays. I'm a little bit uncertain about that result. It looks kind of good, but there's nothing about account tenure in the simulation. So this is a little bit random. Anyway, but these are the cohorts for the simulation that we ran. And now we're going to look, I think we're ready to go on to the new subject for today. God, I spent a lot of time reviewing. If you're on the stream and you think I should cut down on the review, let me know. But the thing is, it's only review if you were actually on my stream yesterday. So I don't know how many people were actually watching yesterday's stream. I think Nicole was. Anyway, so let's see. So we looked at listing 5.1. We looked at the results, which were a bunch of metric cohorts. And now, finally, we're going to do a new subject for today, which is scored data sets. So what is scoring metrics? You probably actually heard of this before if you're a statistician or a data scientist, but you probably called it normalization or standardization or z-scores. Now, why do I call it scoring? This is actually one of the big themes of my book, which is that you need to communicate with business people, and that means laying off on the jargon. So I try not to use a lot of jargon. So I call this subject scoring because when you talk to business people and you tell them these are metric scores or these are scores for the metrics, they're like, okay, that's interesting. What's a score? If you tell them these are normalized values, they tend to shut down because normalization is a big word. Also standardization, terms like that scare business people. So I try to avoid them. So I call it scoring. And we're going to say more detail what exactly scoring is in a moment. At a high level, scoring is grading on a curve, if you've ever heard of that expression. That's where grading on a curve means if the professor gives like a hard test and the average on the test is 70, then you can just say 70 is a B, and then like an 80 is an A, and a 60 is a C. So that's like grading on a curve. That's an English expression. I don't know if other people say that or not. So grading on a curve for your metrics, why? It corrects for skew and imbalances, and it makes it easier to compare customers by the average and standard deviation. And it's also very important for techniques that come later in the book. If you're a statistician or a data scientist already, you know that scoring or normalization is important for regression. It's also very important for dimension reduction, which means reducing the number of variables in your data. And we'll look at all that later. But for now, we're going to learn how to do the scoring. So first, I've got my little illustration of the concept of scoring and why you do it. On the left, I've got an illustration of a bunch of customers ranked by a metric. And they're all crowded at the bottom. You notice that? How all these customers, they're all crowded at the bottom, and there's one extreme outlier at the top. And now this is what you really have in your real data. And let's go back a little bit, because I want to show you. Look at this metric cohort for my real, this is real data, not simulated. Everyone is kind of crowded in this range here between 0 and 5,000 calls per month. But then we have these outliers where someone's got, what's that? 300,000, or is that 30,000? No, 30,000 calls per month. Sorry, I can't read it. So everyone's crowded here. And then the same thing for these other real case studies. Like most of the Clipfolio users have less than like 25 edits per month. But then we have these crazy editors, the power users, who have more than 150 edits per month. So really, real data from real companies all looks like this, and it's the power user effect. You've just got a few people who are just like hammering it. For a business product, it could be a multi-user account, and for a consumer product, it's actually weird. You have the same thing in consumer products. I don't know if it's people who share their IDs or some, you know, really some people who really just power users. I don't know. So you have everyone crowded at the bottom and a few people out at the top. But when you convert your metric to a score, the way I'm going to show you, you spread everyone out. And that's one of the most important things about it. So the customers become more evenly distributed over the range. Also, the scores are small numbers with zero mean, that means zero average, and one standard deviation. And that also makes the scores useful for comparing your customers. It's just kind of easier. And there are more important things about scores later in the next chapter. But for now, let's just go with this. So this is the idea of scoring. And let's do actually a little score algorithm. So I use a slightly non-standard scoring algorithm that I'm going to tell you now. I mean, it's pretty well known, but for some reason, not everyone uses it, or not everyone knows about it. And it's actually using a log transform, and that's really the key to handling the skewed metrics. So this is showing the scoring algorithm in a little toy problem. If I have these metrics shown here and plotted here, and just like in a real metric kind of thing, everyone's crowded down at the bottom, and then you have a few outliers at the top. So the first step in my version of metric scores is add one to the metric. Why? That's useless. Because then you're going to take the log. Now, does anyone online know why you add one before taking the log? I'll wait 1 second, see if anyone comes in on the chat with the answer. I'll give you the answer. Laplace, no. It's actually that you can't take the log of zero. Yeah, it's the log of zero. It is a zero problem, but you can't do logs of zero. It's like undefined, if I recall correctly. Yes, log zero is bad. So I add all these metrics that we're looking at are count metrics, where someone can have a zero, which means they did the action zero times. So zero becomes one becomes two, and on up. I just offset everything by one and then take the log. And the offset by one doesn't really matter given all this other stuff we're gonna do. So you don't wanna take the log of zero. Here, look at this example on the bottom. Zero becomes one, and then when you take the log of one, you get back to zero. But if you took the log of zero, you'd be screwed. Okay, so this is the non-standard part of my scoring. The rest of this is pretty standard. You calculate the average after taking the log and the standard deviation. In this case, the standard deviation is practically one, but this is a toy example. Then we take the subtract the average from the log that we calculated in step three, and then divide by the standard deviation, and that's the score. And steps 4 through 6 are actually standard. So that's your standard z-score, for those of you who have studied that before. And I include the logarithmic transform as part of this because it really helps with the problem of skew and the fact that the power users have extreme values. So that's the explanation. Let's go to the code. And that should be more fun than listening to me talk. Well, actually, no, you'll still have to listen to me talk when we go to the code, because I don't know, because only the streamer gets to talk. Someone's got to talk. It'll have to be me. So here's my metric score algorithm. And what this algorithm does is it takes an entire data set and converts it to a score data set. One thing I didn't mention is that we only take the log transform for skewed metrics. So there's a parameter here called the skew threshold, and that means that every metric with a skew greater than 4 is gonna get the log transform, and every metric where the skew was not greater than 4, we're just gonna do the standard z-score transform. All right, so let me make a run configuration in my usual way of just duplicating an old one and writing in the new listing number, listing 3. And now we can debug it and go through the steps. Laplace smoothing was what you were looking for. Did not study for this pop quiz. I'm sorry, I actually shouldn't give pop quizzes. I don't want my stream to be something like intimidating where people feel like, I don't know, you're gonna get quizzed. So no quiz, just people feel free to throw stuff out. We have no shaming for anyone giving wrong answers in this stream. I'm a real live data scientist and I make a lot of mistakes. Just throwing that out there. So I'm very understanding of people who make mistakes in data science. No one gets it right all the time. Anyway, so here's the metric scoring algorithm. We've hit the breakpoint, and as usual, the first step will be loading the data set into a data frame. I won't actually try to look at it because I looked at it earlier in the stream, and those of you who were here then recall it crashed my computer, which really sucks when you're live streaming. So I copy the data set here using the data frame copy function. And here we actually drop the churn column. So the churn is the outcome variable, which is very important, but we're gonna put it back on later. Now the next thing I do is I actually reload the statistics, because we're gonna use the statistics that were previously calculated. You might wonder why my code is constantly like saving out stuff into a folder, and it's because a lot of this gets reused later on. And I didn't make a fancy system for storing it. But so this is the stats. Here this assert line will check that we've run it. I think we ran it, yeah. So then we load it, and let's look at it. This is a small little data frame, so I should be able to show it to you without crashing. Whoops. Let's see. Oh no, that's the wrong variable. That's the stat path. Let's look at the stats. This is just to prove to you that these are the same stats we were looking at before. So we've got the is churn row and then all the metrics, like per month, new friend per month. And importantly, I have the skew in a column here. I also have the standard deviation and the mean, which are all things we're gonna need later. So I reload the stats that I saved before, and I also drop the churn column from it. Now this is important because this is where I'm gonna make a list of what the skewed columns are. Because remember, there was a threshold on the skew, which I defaulted to 4, which is kind of a rule of thumb that if your skew is 3 or less, it's not that skewed. And if it's 4 or more, or 5 or more, it's pretty skewed. And in real data for customer behaviors on online products, it's usually very heavily skewed. The examples I make are realistic. So let's see. So what do we do next? So we figure out what are the skewed columns here, where the skew threshold is greater than 0, and also you have to check that the minimum is greater than 0. All these metrics have a minimum of 0, so no problem there. So this, let's see, what do we got in this skewed columns list? Okay, I guess it's a set of series. trying to remember how this works, honestly. So let's see, so this is now my skewed columns data frame, I think. Yeah, I made a data frame of all the skewed columns, and we can look at the names of them, I think, with a columns variable? No, what is it in a pandas data frame? Anyone remember what's the variable? I'll just look for it here. I'm trying to remember how we get the column names out of this damn thing. Let's see, I thought it was columns, this is like underscore columns. Anyone remember? Columns of pandas data frame, I'm failing my data science interview here. Let's see, well I wanted to show you, oh here we can see what the skewed columns are. Like per month, new friend per month, post per month, if I mouse over this variable. Ad view per month. So really a lot of them were skewed. Anyway, so let's get on with the transforms. So we go through the skewed columns now, and for each of those skewed columns, we're gonna do that log transform. One log of one plus the values in the column. And so this is it. You do it for the whole column at once using pandas. And then in the stats, I'm gonna replace the mean and the standard deviation. So remember, the stats were what I saved on the normal data, but now I need a new mean and standard deviation on the data that has had the log transform. Because when we do the z-score, the final step, we've got to get the mean and the standard deviation after taking the log. So that's what this is doing. So let me go on to get out of that loop. So I've gone over this, looped over all of these skewed metrics, and now's the step where I subtract the mean and divide by the standard deviation. And again, this is done with the pandas data frame operations. So I'm basically, the stats mean, this is a vector, and then the standard deviation is a vector. And so this is doing the normalization for the entire data frame at once in this one liner. And that's it. Index series have no columns. Oh, was that it? Wait, was I looking at a series? Okay, yeah, index is for the row names, essentially, or the row index. I was trying to remember what the columns was. Maybe that was my problem, is that I was looking at a series and not a data frame. All right, well, I failed my data science interview once today. Let's just keep going. So here's actually where we put back on the churn column. So I remember we dropped the churn column earlier because it wasn't going to get any of these operations. And here we just attach it back on to our new score data frame. And then we save it. And that's actually the end of the scoring algorithm. So it's pretty close to a standard scoring, but with the log scaling. And I actually save it in a file, which we should be able to find right here. If I sort by the date modified. Okay, so here is the dataset scores. Let's see, I'll try to open it. Sometimes I crash when I open Microsoft Excel files. I should open the regular dataset too. Let's see, I had it open before I crashed. I want to show you the regular data set for comparison. This is the regular data set we made yesterday in the stream, and I've already formatted it. So here's a regular data set. We've got one account observation on each row, one metric per column, and here all the metrics are like regular numbers, like per month, new friend per month. Now let's look at the score data set. I'll make this a little bigger, easier to see. And you'll start to see some differences. First difference, well, the difference that you can see is that all of these metrics look like they're small numbers, and they're all they're all real values. I'm gonna like make these smaller. Whoops. Let's get some of these. What do I have to do? I have to reformat these. All right. There we go. Now you can see that these are all now small numbers close to zero. They tend to be between -3 and 3. And there's actually no more zeros, you'll see. There's no one who has, practically no one has exactly zero score. So in your scores data, you've converted all the metrics to a rescaled version, just like we expected. Now let's check our score data set by calculating the stats. So remember that we calculated that table of statistics. Let's go back to it, somewhere back here. Here we go. We called it the data set overview. So listing 5.2 was used to calculate this stat summary of the data set. Now there's actually another version saved for the listing in the book to rerun the stats. And let's run it right now. First, I'm gonna go to the configuration to remind myself which version it is. This is actually all in the book. So the book will tell you, after you calculate the scores from the data set to run these stats. This is the listing configuration for all the listings. And this is actually what I was working on yesterday. We were making new versions of some of these listings. So this is listing to dataset stats. And you can see there's a lot of saved versions that come with the book. And the one that we want, I think, is version 2. And that's because it uses the dataset scores as the path. So in order to rerun these stats after you have made the scores, all you have to do is edit your configuration to do Chapter 5 Listing 2 Version 2. This is my version parameter over here. So this is going to rerun the stats on the metric scores, and they're going to be very different. I'm not going to step through it. This just like saves it out to a new summary stats file. And this is actually going to confirm some of the things I told you about the data set. All right, here's the new summary stats based on the data set scores instead of the regular data set. And as promised, the mean is zero, or practically zero. Well, the is churn, that's not a normalized variable. So that's our outcome. So ignore this row. I'm gonna like move this down to the bottom. So for all the real metrics, as promised, the mean is zero and the standard deviation is one. There you go. Now, what happened to those skews? Remember, the metrics were very, very skewed before. And now the highest skew remaining is two. All of these skews are now practically zero. So this did a really great job of getting rid of the skew in these metrics. Now, this is actually a little bit too good to be true, I'll be honest. In a real data set with real data, you won't get rid of the skew quite so well. The reason it works great for the simulation, I'll let you in on a secret, is because the simulation is also using a log normal distribution to generate the behaviors. So the behaviors were actually generated with a mathematical technique using exponents and logs. And this method of scoring like precisely reverses that, the simulation method of generating outliers. But it's not really gonna work out quite this neatly in real data. That's all I'm saying. Anyway, for the minimum and the maximum, let me reformat these all as numbers so you can see. So the minimums and maximums tend to be small numbers, kind of like between -3 and 3, roughly. Some of these maximums are a little bit higher, but that's not the point. But they're all a lot more reasonable numbers now. So that is creating the score data set. Now, what can we do with a score data set? One thing we can do is do our metric cohorts, and we'll just do the metric cohorts again. Let's see, I think I have that next. Oh, okay, this is my summary. Non-standard z-scores. I already told you this, but this is the slide where I remind myself what the main point is and make sure that I gave the main point like 8 times. Maybe 8 times would be too many. So why don't I use standard linear z-scores? Because of the extreme skew which you see in typical customer behavior data. You have some power users, or in business-to-business products, you have business accounts, and you might have a business account with 100 users and a business account with 3 users. And the business account with 100 users is going to have those extreme metric values in comparison to the business account with 3 users. So that's why we use the nonlinear scale transform. And this is my data ninja icon, which I have a terrible emote for, which I promise I'm gonna make a better emote for any day now. Looks like an acorn, but for now that's the data ninja. And that means this is a very good technique to remember. You will, using these non-standard log transform Z scores, or you know, non-standard scores, is a very good trick to remember. Okay, so next let's look at cohorts using the scores. And this is actually pretty easy to do because I've saved a new data set, which is just my score data set. And now I can just rerun exactly the same scoring code as we ran earlier. I just have to go back to my configuration and figure out which one is the score version. So if I go back to listing 1 and I look at the cohort plot configuration, if you haven't seen this configuration before, it's a JSON, I should just mention, organized by chapter and listing for all the listings in the book. And then each listing has 1 default version, which is if you run it without a version parameter. And then we have versions, where if you run it, you know, with parameters. So for listing 1, I want to find the versions that use the data set scores, which is actually just version 2. Yeah. So if I run version 2, it's going to use the default here, which will be post per month, but it'll use the scores instead of the regular. So let's just do that. And we can do some more after that. So now we're at version 2, yeah, but listing 1. I think I'm doing this a bit out of order from the book. But cool. Should I step through the cohort again, or has everyone seen that? I don't know if I have new people watching who might want to see how the cohort plots work. I think I'll just skip it unless someone chimes up in the chat and says they want to see it again. So let's just run this, and we'll do a cohort using the scores data set. And it says it in the name here. So it says this is now for the data set scores. Go back to the save folder. And this is the cohort here for this one. This is the new one. This is for post per month, but we're using scores instead of the natural scale metrics. So now you can see that the cohort averages go from around minus 1.5 to 1.5. Let's find the old post per month plot. Let's see. Like per month, message, new friend. Okay, here's the old one for post per month. Just gonna save that up here for our consideration. Here's the new one, which is the post per month converted into scores. So now the average is zero, so you actually know exactly where on your cohort plot the average value is. It's between, you know, these cohorts here. Whereas that if you look at this version, which is your original version, you don't really know what the average is, and it's very skewed. But it's interesting, you can note that the probabilities are exactly the same in these two versions. I'm gonna try to get them side by side for you. The probabilities are exactly the same because the transformation from metrics to scores is, it preserves the order. So that if someone had the lowest value of the metric, they'll have the lowest value of the score. And if someone had the highest value of the metric, they'll have the highest value of the score. So the order in the metric is exactly the same as the order in the score. And that means that who's in your cohort is exactly the same each way too. So this first cohort on the left, calculated with the natural scale metric, is exactly the same customers as the first cohort in the score, and so on. And you can even see, you see how, isn't the old one better for business people? Yes, actually, Mikola ZTK, you are 100% right that the one on the left is better for business people who haven't been trained. There are some cases when you know, you get your business people trained up a bit, then they'll know, then they'll understand scores and you can show them the version with the scores. But yeah, for first pass, definitely give the business people the one on the left, and you use the one on the right sometimes. So anyway, I was just making continuing the explanation. You can really see that it's exactly the same churn rate in every cohort. And on the plot on the right, we've just like spread everything out. You might want to use these for business people if you have really, really bad skew. Like the skew can be so bad that everything's like compacted into a small area on the left. And then it's just good to, you know, spread it out. It just makes it a lot clearer, I think. So yeah, but that's basically it. And you can calculate the same kind of cohorts for all the other metrics as well. So that was doing score versions with of the metric cohorts, and you can run them all in exactly the same way. I probably won't run them all again today. I wanted to do something different in the rest of the stream. Let's see, which is talking more about cohort cleanup and trying to do a better example of it. Because if you were watching my last stream, which was just yesterday, I sort of had a fail. I was trying to demonstrate a technique for cleaning data and then doing cohorts, and my example didn't come out that well. So I wanted to come up with a better example. But so on this slide, let's see, what am I saying here? Sometimes it's convenient to remove certain observations, zeros or other kinds of extremes from your cohorts. It could be a kind of data cleaning, but it's sort of just for presentation purposes when we're doing the cohort. Use cases can be looking at disengaging behaviors and free or partner subscription. So now I'm gonna have a better example. I tried to make an example yesterday with a rare metric, and that was the wrong example. So one example I wanna make is disengaging behaviors, and then we'll consider free and partner subscriptions. So this is an example of a real case study with a disengaging behavior. Now, what do I mean by a disengaging behavior? I mean a behavior where the more people do it, the more likely they are to churn. So far, we've only looked at examples where the more someone does something, the less they churn. But there really are cases where the more someone does something, the more they churn. But a lot of times they look like the cohort here on the left. This is a feature X. I don't say what it is because it's a disengaging feature. This is from Clipfolio. I forgot to put their logo on it, but this is data courtesy of Clipfolio. You see this cohort plot on the left where those with zero have a higher churn rate, and those with a metric of one or a little bit more than zero churn less. And then for these remaining cohorts, the churn rate seems to increase slightly, but it doesn't really look like much. Now, this is a pretty classic case of a disengaging behavior because the highest churn rate is actually not the people who do the disengaging behavior, it's the people who don't do anything. And that's good to remember. Even when you have a bad or disengaging behavior or feature in your product, it's usually the case that the worst thing is to not use the product at all. And that's what you're seeing on the left here. So those who don't use the product at all churn the most, and those who use the product even a little bit, as measured by this feature, churn less. But then it looks like those who use the feature more churn a little bit more. And how can you see that more clearly is actually to take the zeros out of the data. So I took all the zeros out of the data. So now this cohort plot was created in exactly the same way, but with all the customers with zeros removed. And then it finds different cohorts, because this is like the default cohorting behavior of the Q-cut function. And when you remove these accounts here, you can actually see the trend a lot more clearly, that more of this behavior leads to higher churn rates. So this is actually a good trick to remember. Got to do another like data ninja for this one. If you do your cohorts and you see this kind of hook shape where the zeros have the highest churn rate, but then churn seems to increase, remove the zeros and rerun it. And then you'll actually get a clearer view of the impact of the disengaging behavior. And here you can see that those who do this behavior a lot have about 30% or a third higher churn rate than those who don't do the behavior so much. So that's a real case of a disengaging behavior. And that's when you might want to clean your data a little bit before doing cohorts. All right, now let's do a live hack. Another thing where you might want to clean your data before doing cohorts is when you have partners or some kind of special class of user who don't use the product very much, but they don't have to pay for it. So partners get a free ride, basically, and they tend to never churn. And so this can actually screw up your churn cohorts because you want to understand how the level of behavior is related to churn for real users or normal users. Example of disengaging behavior, please, from Mikola ZTK. Actually, disengaging behaviors are very rare. It's pretty uncommon to find them. Why? Well, usually people try to make the product good. So you've had a lot of product managers and product designers and content creators working to make sure everything's good and nothing's bad. And very occasionally there will still be some kind of feature where the more people do it, the worse it is. That's one type of disengaging behavior. There's actually another kind of disengaging behavior. This is getting where it's really thinking about correlation and causation, is when the feature is good, but your product really has only one purpose. And the classic example of this is a dating website for long-term relationships. Now imagine a dating service for long-term relationships. What happens when you find a long-term relationship on that service? You churn, right? Or you're not really into your long-term relationship. But if you use the service properly and a dating service for long-term relationships or marriage, you find your marriage partner, you should churn, shouldn't you? You shouldn't stay on the marriage website or marriage service once you've found your spouse. So there are many products where actually success leads to churn. Another good example of this is a streaming service with only one good series. What happens if your streaming service has only one good series? Then people who watch the whole series churn. They're like, oh, I saw all that, I'm done. And that's rare, but it does happen, a service with only one good series. Then people do more of the good thing, but it's actually disengaging because once they've watched the whole service, they're done and they quit. So sometimes you have disengaging behaviors where it's actually a bad aspect of the product that no one's fixed. Another kind of disengaging behavior could actually be the purpose of the product itself may be one that can be fulfilled. And in those cases, the products need to come up with more stuff for people to do, like another good series. So examples of disengaging behaviors are pretty hard to find, actually, in real products and services. So don't be surprised if you only see engaging behaviors in a real product or service. Okay, so that was a digression into the disengaging behaviors. Now I wanted to do a live hack where I make some partners in the simulated data set. And so I'm basically gonna make some more observations where they have little or no behavior and they never churn. And I'm gonna do it as a quick hack. I actually do this with an example in the book. Oh, I should have opened up that example. In chapter 5, where's that example? Page 210. I should like open this up. I'll open this up later. I do an example. I'll try to do this right now. But in the book, there's an example where I hacked a data set with free partners. So now I'm just gonna get into the hacking here. And I'm gonna basically make a new data set. And I'm gonna do it just by going to my old data set and I'm gonna save it. Let me just forget this for now. Here's the old data set. I'm gonna save this as a new name. I'm gonna call this dataset partners. And I'm just gonna make a bunch of records for the partners by pretty much just copying a bunch of the regular data. And I wanna resort this a little bit. So I wanna get a cross-section of the accounts. All right, I've resorted and I wanna go down to the bottom and add my new partner accounts. And I'm just gonna say, I have to give them an account ID. And I'm just gonna say this is A1 plus 20,000. Whoops, what happened there? Oh, it's A2 plus 20,000, sorry. Live hacking, easy to make mistakes. And I'm just gonna copy this date. I just wanna copy these. And this is gonna be false because remember my partners are never gonna churn because they don't have to pay. So now I wanna make some special data for the partners. I'm gonna say the partners don't have to look at ads. They don't have any, I guess they can have unfriends. So we're gonna say the partners don't do messages because that's not one of their partner features. And I'm gonna say, maybe they like a little bit, but not a lot. I'm just gonna say they don't do that much. So for these other behaviors, I'm gonna say the partners, because partners maybe, some of them are active, but most of them are probably not. So I'm just gonna say D2 divided by 20. So I want to just basically come up with a formula for making partners who are not so active on my service. Whoops, trying to round it off. Maybe I need a number of digits here. There we go. So these are going to be my inactive users who have no messages, and they churn, and they have, I don't know, they have long tenure. I guess I'll just say they have longer tenure, so I'm going to say they have 10 times the tenure of a regular account. So now I'm just going to basically copy paste a bunch of these fake accounts into my data set. They never churn and they have little behavior. Whoops. Hey, don't do that. So we started out with 30,000 accounts. Let's paste in another, I don't know, I want to paste in a bunch. So let's see. How should I get down there? So when I paste in a bunch of these accounts, let's go to like 35,000. So we'll have 5,000 partners and 30,000 regular accounts, roughly. Let's see. All right, so here's my paste, copy paste of a bunch of partner accounts. Let's get up to 35,000. All right, so now here are all my new partner accounts that they never churn and they don't use the service a lot. So let's look at what this does to some of our cohorts. Although the first thing I'll have to do is save this out into a CSV format, which is always risky. We'll see what happens when I try to reload my CSV. But I want to save this as a CSV and reload it as a new data set to do this hack. All right, so now I have a new data set with partners in it. And let's see. Guess I can close that up now. All right, so I have a data set with partners. Now I have to go back and reset my cohort plots to run with this new data set, and that's done using the configuration which we saw earlier. It's this JSON configuration. So what I need to do is make a new set of metrics to plot that have the right data set path. And let's see. Well, this was my bad example yesterday. I'm going to delete that one. I'm going to copy these configurations. And call them the 30 series of configurations. So this is like, this will be 31, 32, 33, 34. So I'm just defining new keys for these configurations. And now I need to give the new data set. Now let's skip the account tenure. We'll look at these other ones. Now I need to give these configurations a new data set, like this, but I have to modify that. So I wanted this to be subnet 2 dataset underscore partners, because that was the new hack data set that I made just earlier. Okay, so this hack is almost ready for our example. I just need to, let's try running this one actually. So we want to run listing 1 version 31. And let's just make sure everything is right here. Let's see, did it run? Yep, so I got a new cohort for new friends per month measured on the partners. And actually doesn't look too bad, actually. This one looks kind of the same. So maybe I haven't messed with their data enough. See, that can be a problem with this. If I haven't messed with the data enough, it'll still look normal. Let's see. Yeah, I haven't actually prepared this in advance, so hopefully it'll work. So let's see. Let's do the other cohorts in our partner data set. And I'm just adding that setting to use this data set. Let's look at messages per month and replies per month, actually, because those are the ones that the partners don't even do. Let's do 34 and 35. So remember, partners have no messages and replies per month. Let's see if we messed up the data enough. Well, you can kind of see it a little bit on this one. I think we didn't make enough partners. So this is, I think, partly the impact of the partners shown up here, that they never churn, but they don't have a lot of messages. But why isn't there? I'm trying to think this through. I thought I made 5,000 partners that all have zero on message per month and reply per month. And they never churn. So why don't they look worse? I might have done a bad job on my live hack here too. I'm like 0 for 2 on my live hacks this weekend. What is going on with these partners? That's the wrong window. Let's see. So let's see. Opening up the partner data set again. Let's see. Actually, wait, I didn't add as many as I thought. I'm only up to 21,000. Is that the problem? Also, my observation dates are all messed up. I don't know why that happens. So, why are the partners? I'm looking at this data set more closely because I thought I should have had more customers with zero messages and zero replies per month, because those were my partners who I started the partners out around 30,000. Maybe I need more partners. I don't know what to say. I think we need more partners. Oops. I'm gonna try adding some more partners and doing this again. I'm just scrolling down a ways to make a bunch more partner accounts. Now this data set should be 25% people, practically, partners. Whoa. Got a little carried away there. All right, so now this should be pretty messed up data. I'm gonna save as CSV again and try rerunning this. Maybe I didn't open the right data file. All right, let's try running it again. Maybe I should debug it actually. We're supposed to be doing, I'm also gonna do some stats. That's actually a good way to check. I'll make a new version of my stats, which will be for my partner data. So again, this is how you add another configuration with a different data set path. I'm just gonna go over here and edit this one to say dataset2_partners, which is my hacked up data that has the bad examples. So So let's see. I have a new data set. Let's run the stats on it. This is listing 2 version 11. Okay, not a valid data set path. Okay, well that's a problem. Let's check that I got it right. SocialNet 2 underscore dataset underscore partners. Oh, okay, that's what it should be. All right, now let's try it. All right, so now I have new stats for the partners data set. I just want to verify that I've messed it up sufficiently. So what I'm expecting to see is a lot of zeros in messages and replies in comparison to the original data set. And this looks right, actually. So here, if I look at these percent non-zero, almost everyone had messages and replies before. But now only 66% have replies and only 75% have messages. So we should see more zeros in the cohort plot this time. And if this doesn't work, I'm gonna give up, because hopefully this will give us a slightly better result to look at. But also this is instructive, hopefully, to anyone watching this who wants to know how to hack the data and try some of it. Because not everything that I explain in the book is there actually simulated data to run it on. And I didn't want to, you know, go through all these complicated hacks in the book. But, you know, it can be interesting to do in your own time. So let's go back to listing 1, and I'm going to rerun 31, 32, 33... 34 and 35, and I'll just get all those cohort plots out and see if any of them look any different for the partners data set. Whoops. No numeric. What the heck? Am I doing the wrong listing? Chapter 5, listing 1. What's the problem? This looks okay to me. No numeric types to aggregate. Oh great, now I've got a bug. Seems like something's wrong with my loading the data set. Live hacking. Takes a few times to get it right. Let's look at this churn data now. I know this is what crashed my computer before, so am I feeling lucky? Let's view as a data frame. I haven't crashed yet, but it's not showing me anything. Okay, there we go. Now this actually looks fine. Let's see, maybe I've got a bad metric name. That could explain the crash. Let's stop this and let's try just running the ones that I knew worked before, 34 and 35. Whoops. These are the old ones. Let's see if these work. No, something's wrong. All right, I screwed up something in the data now. Do I not have the column names in the new data set? That could be a problem. I might have saved it too fast. All right, feeling lucky, view as data frame. Come on. Don't crash. All right, haven't crashed yet. Ah, God, this all looks fine. happening. That's where it crashes. What was the problem there? This says no numeric types to aggregate. All right, I think I screwed up something when I saved it as CSV. Not quite sure. But this is not good. Let's see. All right, there's no substitute for looking at your data sometime. Let's see. Don't need to look at this anymore. Closing all these up. So what is the problem here? I feel like the partner data set looks fine. This is actually a very real hazard. If you save anything as CSV from Microsoft Excel, it often screws your shit up. So that's like, be warned. And that's one thing I'll say. I am not really seeing the problem in this. So, man, this all looks fine. All right, I might have to give up on this again. I think I'm gonna give up and finish this hack later. All right, I'll prepare it for next time and I'll really do a good example that doesn't screw up in the middle. I'm sorry, people. I've gone astray here. I'm gonna have to come up with a new live hack to demonstrate this technique next time. I'm just gonna hit the summary and call it a day. I'll get this working again, and then I'll come back with a new stream next week that shows you how this really works. So another fail. I'm 0 for 2 on the live hacks this weekend. Sorry about that. But that's the risk you take when you do a live hack. You never know if it's gonna work. And at a certain point, anticipation levels are high. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know why that wasn't worked. But like I said, anytime you're screwing around with your data in Microsoft Excel and trying to reload it in Python, it's kind of a recipe for disaster. Let me go through my summary. So Fighting Churn is about targeted interventions, improvements, engagement, and customer support. Metrics summarize customers' events and subscriptions. Metric cohort is a technique you saw to say, it's good to see code failing. That's the natural state. Yes, it's true. Thanks, Nicole. It's what you get when you try to live hack some code with other people watching. But I don't want to spend too much time on it today. Oh, thanks, Nicola to ZTK. You still think it was a great stream, even though my live hack was a complete failure? Well, we learned about metric cohorts, and I explained how they're easy to understand and act on without your business users doing a bunch of math. And we also looked at metric scores. That was actually the new point of today's stream, was I was going to show metric scores, which is like grading on a curve. It evens out the distributions. It makes averages and the deviation from the average easier to compare. And there's actually more important benefits of the scores, which I'm going to go over in the next chapter. Oh, thanks, Nicole. Glad you liked the stream, too. Let's see. I think that's all the summary. And I'll just go through these other things here at the end. Oh, removing extremes may help cohort interpretation, but only if your data isn't messed up. And I don't know what was messed up with that data, but I'm going to fix it next time, and I'll do a really good example of removing extremes from data before doing cohorts. Let's see. Okay, this is my slide reminding people about the book and the discount code, 40% off if you get the book from Manning. But like I keep saying, if you watch these streams, no need to buy the book. All the code's on GitHub. And if you watch the stream, you should be able to figure it all out. This is my schedule now. I say new year, new schedule, because I was going a little bit different last year. But so now I'm doing my Saturday stream is meant to be my Australia Asia friendly time at 3 p.m. This was meant to be my European friendly time, which is for me 12 p.m. But yeah, so every weekend I work at my day job all week, so I'm not really streaming. And new, I have a YouTube channel now where I post all of these videos on demand after the stream. So basically I record the stream and then I just do a little, you know, touch up and then I post it on YouTube. So I'll have a library going over every chapter. So that's new. Also, there's these other ways to connect with me, LinkedIn. Definitely follow me on Twitter. I'll give you all the updates about fighting churn, the subscription economy, and I stay away from politics and cat pictures and stuff like that. So hope you can join me. And again, of course, good to have you all following me here on Twitch. So that's it for this week. I'll be back next Saturday. Hope you all have a good week. For many of this is going to be our first week back after a vacation. I know for me, I've been home on vacation for, you know, more than a week now. It's going to be kind of sad to go back, but hey, do what you got to do. I'm glad to have a good job to go back to, and I'll be excited to see all my coworkers on Zooms, even if I'm not really excited to spend hours and hours a day on Zoom again. That was actually the best thing about my week off, is that I wasn't spending hours a day on Zoom meetings. Because in my time off, I was still kind of hacking. I was working on some data science projects. I mean, working on this streaming project, which is like a data science project for me. So I wasn't idle on my time off, but I didn't have to go to a lot of Zoom meetings all day, which is, I don't know, pretty pleasant. So yeah, I hope you all have a great week back at work if you're going back to work or whatever you happen to be doing. Enjoy the rest of your Sunday. I'll fix the live hack for next week and see you then. So take care. Thanks for joining me again.